Hello students, myself Renuka. I welcome you all on the second chapter of Economics, that is People as Resource Part 2. Note that agriculture is an example of both market and non-market activity. Agriculture on a large scale, where a farmer produces enough for himself and is left with a surplus to sell and make a profit, is a market activity. However, agriculture on a small scale, just to feed the farmers and his family, is a non-market activity. Now, let us look at the kind of economic activities performed by men and women. These are a little different, as traditionally we have separate roles defined for men and women in a family. In our society, men are expected to go out and work to earn money and provide for the family. Women are generally expected to stay at home and look after household chores like cooking, cleaning, washing, and looking after the children. The men get paid for the work they do. Their work contributes to national income. However, the women never get paid for the hard work by housekeeping work they do. Their work does not contribute towards national income. Time has changed. Now, today, women also go out to work and get paid just like men. How much a person can earn depends on his or her education and vocational skills. A large number of women with poor education and skill are employed in an unorganized sector doing manual work like rolling incense sticks, making matches, picking tea leaves. This has several disadvantages. The main disadvantages for women employed in unorganized sector are: less wages than men, low and irregular income, no job security and legal protection, and absence of basic facilities like maternity leave, medical care and child care. However, women with higher education and advanced skills secure high paying jobs as teachers, doctors and administrative officers in the organized sector. In the organized sector, women get paid at par with the male colleagues and enjoy all the benefits of a secured job. In line with the modern Indian philosophy of providing equal opportunities to men and women, the highest public post of the president is occupied by a woman, Srimati Pratibha Devi Singh Patil. Education, healthcare, and training make a population asset to a country. Thus, there are three factors that determine the quality of nation's population. Uneducated, untrained, unhealthy people find it difficult to take care of themselves and can do little for society. Thus, they are the nation's liability. Why is education so important? What does it do to make you an asset to your nation? Education unlocks the door of aspiration and opportunities for you and allow you to have good life. Education inculcates good values to make you a better person. Education allows you to find a good employment so that you can contribute to the national income. Education prepares you to become a responsible citizen and contribute to country's good governance. India's nation education policy recognizes the importance of education in tackling the problems and the requirement for a person's growth. Now, let us just look at some steps taken by our government to educate people in our country. India. the national expenditure on education grew from just 151 crore rupees in the first 5-year plan of 1951 to 43,825 crore rupees in the 10th plan of 2002. From 1951 to 2002, the expenditure on education rose from just 0.4% to 3.98% of our gross domestic product. The government is in the process of establishing the Navodaya Vidyalaya in every district of our country to provide universal access to education to all children with special emphasis on girls. The central government has also launched the Sarva Siksha Abhiyan in partnership with the state and the local government. This is a time-bound initiative to provide free compulsory elementary education to all children between 6 and 14 years of age by 2010. The 10th five-year plan 2002 to 2007 focused on the increasing the enrollment of students from 18 to 23 years of age in higher education. The 10th plan also aimed to contribute formal, informal and distance education to provide better access to education students in all parts of the country. The government aims to provide vocational training even to high school students. However, many well-paying skills are required through higher education in college after school. The number of universities and colleges of higher studies have grown in number since 1951. Still, these are not enough to accommodate all the aspiring students in the country. The chart here shows the rise in the number of college students and teachers of India between the 1951 to 1999. Clearly, the number of teachers has not increased in proportion with the large increase in the number of students. The state of education in the country is measured by its literacy rate. Let us see the trend of literacy rate of India. The chart here shows the change in the literacy rate in India from 1951 to 2001. You can see that the literacy rate is continuously on the rise. You can also see the literacy rate is higher for the male population than for the female population. This is mainly due to tradition of less emphasis on education of girls. Fortunately, the trend appears to be changing. People in urban areas are more literate than the people in rural areas. Among the states of literacy rate range from 96% in some state districts of Kerala to under 30% in parts of Bihar, Jharkhand. After education and training, let us move to the health. Why staying healthy is important for you? Good health allows you to fight illness and perform your full potential. Good health allows you to work efficiently and to be an asset for the organization you work for. Besides career opportunities and growth, good health is important for your overall well-being as an individual. Our national health policy aims to make healthcare and family welfare programs more accessible to people and provide them with the nutritional guidance and special focus on the poorer section of the society. There has been a tremendous increase in the number of healthcare institutions in India. In the past few decades, health sub-centers, primary health center and community health centers catering to the rural population have grown in large numbers. A good indicator of the increase in the health facilities is the number of hospital beds available in India. Indian doctors are renowned the world over their expertise. The pool of trained doctors and nursing staff has also increased in India, though there is still more requirement for such people. How do you judge the health of a population? The health of the population is indicated by the parameters like life expectancy, infant mortality rate, and birth rate and death rate. Better healthcare facilities increased the average life expectancy in India to 65 years by the year 2000. Infant mortality rate is number of death of children under 1 year of age per 1,000 live births. Children and family care program reduced to the infant mortality rate. In India, from 147 in 1951 to 75 by the year 2000. Birth rate is the number of babies born per 1,000 people in a given time. With the increase of awareness about family planning, the birth rate in India came down to 26.1 by the year 2000. Death rate is the number of death per 1,000 people in a given time with better health care. The death rate in India decreased to 8.7 by the year 2000. Like education, health care facilities are not uniformly distributed in India. For example, states like Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Maharashtra have 81 out of 181 medical colleges in India. The densely populated areas of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh have very few. This is for today. Thank you.